You ever had a dream like that? You're trapped in a really dark place, reaching for the light, but you just can't get there, and everything is weird. Up is down, down is up, left is right, right is left. It seems like every time I read the news today, I feel like the guy in the box here, because what used to be bad is now good. What used to be good is now considered the most despicable evil. What people used to be ashamed of, now they're proud of, and what people are proud of, now they're publicly ashamed for. I think that there are lots of people in the world right now, in our country, who are just like, I'm so confused. Because every single day, it seems like a different group trots out their new version of truth. And they tell you that you have to believe this, you better believe this, no matter how radical that truth might be. And they say, our truth is the truth that's going to change the world, that it's going to make this world a better place. Sometimes I think it feels like we're in this dark box, trying to get out to the light, but we just can't find it. Why is our world changing so much? Why is our country changing so much? Because one of the reasons is that many people, or more and more people, are starting to reject the idea that there could be some kind of absolute truth, something that applies, a truth that applies to every single human being on the planet. And they're exchanging that for the belief that was already pretty common, that human beings construct their own truth. You make your own truth, and whatever makes you happy. And then if you find a big group of people that believe the same truth that you do, then you get together, and when you're the majority, then you make everybody else believe what you believe. And especially if you don't believe in a God, it's even easier, right? Because if there's no God, then there really is no absolute truth. There's nothing that everybody can say, this is the truth, everybody can point to. And there's no supreme being who can hold you accountable to that truth, or who will hold you accountable, or who will judge you for that. So you can basically do whatever you want. Now, the biblical concept is a lot different. And there may be people today who are with us, maybe you're checking us out online or here, who are, you know, maybe trying to find out what Christianity's all about. And maybe you've been told a lot of things about Christianity and about the Bible and how restricting and enslaving it is. But listen to what the Bible has to say. We're going to meditate on a portion of the Bible today. They'll tell us that the Bible doesn't do that. Instead, it leads us toward out of confusion and toward clarity, out of the darkness, toward light, to a solid foundation for our life, not like that box. So let's delve into 2 Timothy chapter 4. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. So the guy writing this is Paul, the Apostle Paul. He's writing a letter to a younger pastor named Timothy, who he is encouraging and teaching a little bit more. And he just states it as a fact, just like the rest of the Bible does, that Jesus Christ will someday judge the world, judge every single human being who's ever lived on this planet when this world is about to end. So that tells us a couple things, that this world isn't the only one there is, that there's another world that's coming. And it also tells us that if that's true, then there must be an objective standard by which he's going to judge, by which God can judge people. Something that says definitively whether something's right or wrong, bad or good or evil. And where is that standard found? How can we know what it is? When Paul said to Timothy, preach the word, he was pointing to it. The word is not just any word. The word was not just any word that Timothy would like to tell people. The word that Paul is talking about is God's word, his communication to human beings. And as a church, Divine Savior Church, believes that the Bible is God speaking to the human race in human language that we can understand. We believe that. But we also know that we live in a world that doesn't want to hear God's truth and doesn't want to acknowledge that maybe the Bible could be the word of God. But it wasn't any easier, I don't think, in Jesus' day Today in the reading, we saw Jesus on trial before Pontius Pilate, and he makes a pretty audacious claim when he says, "The reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." And how does Pilate respond? Just with cynicism, what is truth? Paul and Timothy, the guy who wrote the letter, the guy who received it, didn't live in a world that was easy to follow someone like Jesus who proclaimed absolute truth. Because actually, 2 Timothy is Paul's last letter. He wrote how many letters in the New Testament? I don't even remember. 13? This is the last one. Why? Because he's waiting to be executed, sitting in a Roman jail cell. And, that's just proof, right? Because the Roman government says, "Paul, your truth is not our truth. So you're going to have to die for it." So it wasn't easy. And Paul even says the situation's going to get worse. In verse 3, he says, "For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths." Did you know that every day your gas gauge tells you a myth? I'm not talking about a broken gas gauge. I'm talking one that actually works. Because at least in my car, when I fill up the tank, so the needle goes and it passes the F, right? It goes past the F and it stays there for quite a while, right? And you're waiting for it to move. Like, when is it going to move? And then it starts to move. It gets a little faster and it goes. And then when it gets to E, it passes E. And only at that time does the little light go on my dashboard that is a gas pump. And then there's this ding. And that's Becky's cue to say, "You better go to a gas station." And that's my cue to say, "Honey, we still have 38 miles of gas left. I know this car, I've been driving it for 10 years, and I know exactly how." But the point is, it's not broken. It was designed that way. And automobile engineers have admitted it because they've done studies. They know what American consumers want, and American consumers pay a lot for gas, and they want to think that they're getting better gas mileage than they actually are. So they're willing to be deceived by their gas gauge. Makes us feel good, right? Well, Paul talked about people not tolerating sound doctrine anymore. So the same holds true for truth. When he says sound, that the word in Greek has a literal meaning of healthy. So human beings, he says, don't want healthy doctrine, healthy teaching that comes from the Bible, from the Word of God. We don't want teaching that brings us true health. We just want to feel it. We just want to feel like it. We want to feel like we want to feel and get from God kind of what we want. And why is that? It's because by nature we're spiritually sick, we could say. We have a God complex. That was the original temptation, right? The original lie. You will be like God. And our ancestors fell for that lie, and they passed that nature onto us. And so our human nature still thinks that it believes that lie, right? I need to be my own God. I need to be a God to get the things that I need in order to be happy. And so human beings, by nature, we want to believe the lies, and we don't want to believe God's truth. And for all of us sitting here, we have to admit that it's the same thing for us. Right? We're not here to just criticize other people and say how they hate the truth, because our nature as well, we share the same nature, right? We're here also to do some introspection and to do some healthy criticism of ourselves too. We have the same kind of nature. Now, if you've ever shopped at Costco, you know that they sell a lot of things. A lot of things, right? They sell books too, and they sell Bibles. Anybody ever bought a Bible at Costco? They're pretty cheap. But several years ago, Costco was actually labeling their Bibles as fiction. Do you realize that? They were actually labeling them as fiction, not nonfiction. I don't know if they're still doing it. So the next time I go to buy a 3-month supply of Pop-Tarts, I will look. But they were doing it for a while. And sadly, that's what society does to the Bible, right? It tells us to treat the Bible like that. Treat it like fiction, myth. Nice stories that might reveal some kind of a moral, but not historically accurate and certainly not to be accepted as universal truth. So what do they essentially do? They replace the truth with fiction and believe the fiction instead of the truth. Replace the truth with a myth, with many myths, and believe those instead of the truth. And how does that happen? It happens when you follow your heart. But unfortunately, that's the message we hear all the time, right? Follow your heart. It'll lead you to where you need to go. It'll lead you to your happy place. Follow it, and that's it. And nobody can criticize you for that. But following your heart is the wrong thing to do most of the time because our hearts are sick. Following your heart doesn't lead to clarity or stability or true happiness. It often leads to selfishness, to confusion, instability, division, hostility, fake happiness that doesn't last. We see that happening in our society right now. But if you listen to God's truth, what will he tell you? He would say to you, your heart is sick. Your heart is sick by nature. You're born with a sick heart. And if you follow that heart instead of me, you'll end up in a place that you don't want to be, that you would never want to be. You'll end up separated from me forever. And your life here will be miserable as well. You want to do what I hate and call it good. You want to do evil and call it good. You want to do what I hate, but I can't tolerate evil. And I can't tolerate people who do evil. And you might be believing one of the biggest lies that's out there, and that is the lie that I want to enslave you. Is that what you think I want to do? I want to enslave you? No. What I really want to do is set you free. I want to set you free so you can be the person that I created you to be, so that you can experience the full extent of my love for you and love me freely. So when Pontius Pilate, 2,000 years ago, sent Jesus of Nazareth to the cross, he sent my son to the cross, and that's what I wanted. That's what I wanted. I loved him so much. He was the perfect son, always told the truth, always lived the truth, but I love you so much. And I asked him to suffer the punishment that I should give to you. He did it. So now the worst myth that you can believe is that there's not enough forgiveness for you, or that you have to make yourself worthy of the forgiveness that Jesus won for you. You don't. I love you, and I've forgiven everything. And that means that you can trust me. It means you can trust me to tell you the way to go. It means you can trust me when I tell you whether something is good or bad for you. My gas gauge will never lie to you, never try to deceive you. You don't have to be like the guy in the box, never knowing which way is up. You can stand on solid ground and have peace and joy when you receive my truth, which is unchanging, and believe it. Now, I hope you believe that. Or if you don't now, I hope that God will bring you to believe that. But even if we do, it's not always easy to live in a world that doesn't believe it, right? But the struggle is worth it. Paul says this in verse 5. But you, Timothy, keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. Maybe I should explain that a little bit. A drink offering in some of the sacrifices of the Old Testament, as part of the sacrifice, towards the end, you would pour a cup of wine on the sacrifice as it was burning on the altar as an additional offering to the Lord. So that's what Paul's talking about. He's saying, you know, my life is a sacrifice for Christ, and it's coming to an end. Like he says, my departure is near. He says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. So here Paul calls the Christian life of discipleship a fight. And I think there are Christians today who are kind of taking that literally, and they're fighting to try to make non-Christians behave like Christians. That's their response to what's happening in our society. Christianity, though, is not about forcing people to believe in Jesus. It's not about forcing non-believers to live like believers. It's about something else. When Paul told Timothy, preach the word, that word in Greek, which if you went to Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary, our seminary is on the wall of the chapel, it means to be a herald. Do you know what that means? If you're a herald, think of maybe like back in the last century when newspaper was the way you got your news, right? And then the newspaper kids on the street would be, extra, extra, read all about it, Titanic sinks in North Atlantic. What are they doing? They're just repeating the news. They're just saying, telling you what the news is, right? And that's what being a herald is. It's receiving a message and just repeating it, not adding or subtracting to it. And so that's what we want to do as believers, is to herald that truth, receive that truth, trust that God will use it to change people's hearts, just like he changed ours. And that's what we strive to do as a congregation. But we need to hold on to that truth, right? We need to hold on to the truth if we're going to proclaim it. And that's why Paul said this. He said, I have kept the faith. And you could interpret that in two different ways. Either he's saying, I have remained a believer, you know, I haven't lost my faith. Or he could be saying, I have kept my faith from being corrupted by lies, by false teaching, right? But both are important. Because if I no longer believe in Jesus, then I'm not going to herald his word. And if I let my faith be corrupted and what I believe turn into lies, then I'm going to be heralding lies. So both things are super important. And I think they match with two of our core values at Divine Savior Church. Well, here's one of them. I'm going to mention another one later. And that's, we take the word of God seriously. We take God's truth seriously. We don't want it to be corrupted. And we don't want to believe lies. We want to believe the truth of what God says. Last week, do you remember what the word was? Help me, I'm so, what was it? Ashamed. Mm-hmm. We talked about shame. And shame is a powerful weapon that Satan uses, and he's using more and more in our country. Right? What he really wants for us is to be ashamed of Jesus, be ashamed of being his disciples. Because Jesus said this in Mark 8, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. So Satan would love for us to be so ashamed of Jesus that we hide our faith or that we just stop following Jesus altogether. And we all feel guilt, right, when we break God's law and we feel guilty. But how does shame get a hold of us? Oftentimes it happens from outside, from groups. So when society tells us, this is the truth and you better believe it, if you don't, what happens more and more? You pay a high price in society, publicly, right? You may be banned from social media. You may lose your reputation. You may lose your career, your friends, or your clients. And it's like peer pressure, right? And it's meant to scare you, to make you so afraid of the consequences of being ashamed in front of the whole world that you will say, yeah, that's the truth. But that's not good enough, right? Not only accept the truth, but also be proud of it and proclaim it and then change your beliefs to include that truth. Shame is a powerful weapon because we all want to be liked, isn't it? But it's important to realize that there's real shame and there's false shame. If I do something that brings dishonor on God, if I shame God with my conduct because I oppose his will, then I should be ashamed, right? I should be ashamed. But if I feel ashamed because I'm believing the truth and because I'm practicing what God wants me or living the way God wants me to live, I don't need to be ashamed about that. I don't have to be ashamed. And that's exactly what society does. Right? Tries to convince us as Christians that by believing the truth that the scriptures say and by living the truth that we should be ashamed for it. We shouldn't. That doesn't mean we should be arrogant, right? Well, I live by the truth. No. But we don't have to be ashamed of it. And a lot of times, I think one of the tactics, I would say, is changing the definition of terms, like the word love. So when God loves, he loves you, does he give you everything you want? Thankfully not, right? He doesn't give me everything I want because there's that contamination in my heart that doesn't always want the right things or want to do the right things. He gives me what I need, but now the definition of love has changed. Like, if you don't approve of what I do because I'm following my heart, then you're not loving me. Then you're not letting me be happy because my heart tells me that this will make me happy. And if you oppose that, then you don't love me. Then maybe you even hate me. You're a hater. When we all know our own hearts, but I think that It's not that we hate people. We just hate what God hates. We hate sin because that's what God wants us to do. So changing those terms can deceive us. So remember how God, how he defines the terms. Go by his definitions. Be ashamed of what you should be ashamed of and not of what is good and right and what God wants you to do. It doesn't matter what the world thinks of you. What really counts is what God thinks of you. Life makes sense when our faith is founded on the solid truth of God's word. It's stable. It makes sense. Darkness turns to light. Confusion turns to clarity when God's truth guides us. So be patient. Love people like God loves you, even when they don't believe, even when they don't deserve it. Use the truth of God lovingly and patiently and humbly to point out sin. And then use it to encourage people. God is way more loving than you think. He's not a slave driver. What he all wants to do is just embrace you. So embrace that forgiveness that he offers to you through Jesus that takes away your shame and your guilt and everything else. And then encourage yourself with it. And encourage each other. That's another one of our core values, is that we treat each other like family. The gospel needs to be our daily encouragement. To encourage ourselves with it, to encourage other believers, right? And I think Pastor Caleb mentioned in a sermon recently that just being here with each other is encouragement, right? Say, oh yeah, there are other people here who believe in Jesus still and want to hear his truth. But encourage each other with the gospel, because what does the gospel do? Through the gospel, the good news God promises you, that no matter what the world thinks about you, no matter what verdict they've come to, his verdict is righteous. He's declared you righteous through faith in Christ. No more guilt, no more shame. He declared you righteous when Jesus rose from the dead. And be encouraged to know that there are better things coming. This isn't the only world there is. There's a new kingdom coming, a kingdom of glory. And in that kingdom of glory, he's going to confirm that verdict for you and give you a crown of righteousness. And in that kingdom, it's zero confusion, 100% clarity, zero darkness, 100% light. In that kingdom, everything will be exactly as it should be, and it will be that like that forever. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in that faith in him, believing the truth and walking in it. Amen.